So we have been discussing random walks, and so we saw how some of these key results, namely diffusive motion, how if you take n steps, on average you only cover square root of n of order of square root of n distance. You know, this is one of the characteristic features of diffusive motion, and it comes about it with just simple random walk considerations. We were looking at 1D. And so we saw some exact results. We also saw some ways of simulating this and then comparing one against the other, right? So what I want to do is use the so-called Stirling approximation, which we mentioned in passing, and you know, to see how some of these analytical results which come out of the Stirling approximation are actually excellent approximations, and to check against the numerics and see that in fact they work out very well. So I want to explicitly do this. So we suggested this as an exercise in the past, but so today in this module we'll go into some of the details of this. Okay, so as always, we start by clearing Mathematica of its past memory. So it's a quick recall of, you know, how random walk happens and how you can extract mean and variance of net displacement. So we imagine a walker who starts at the origin, and with probability p he moves to the right, and with probability q equal to 1 minus p he moves to the left after every time step, right? So it's discrete time, discrete space. So he covers one unit of distance in each move, and a time of one unit time elapses before he makes another move, and there is no option for the random walker to not make a move. He has to either go to the right or to the left. And then we looked at how you can study a quantity like n1 and n2, define n1 as the number of steps which are taken to the right, and then a crucial quantity becomes m equal to n1 minus n2, which we can solve for m in terms of n1 and capital N. And then we saw that the average of m is simply given by 2 times n times p minus a half. And then we also saw that there is a nice connection between the variance of this random variable m and the variance of the random variable n1. So in fact, one of them is just 4 times the other, like here. And so the general expression, it turns out, is m squared minus average of m squared is equal to 4npq. And then we quickly looked at the unbiased case when you have p equal to q equal to a half. And then basically, since average of m is anyway going to be 0 for this case, p equal to half, then you get the very important result for random walks, that average of m squared is just equal to n, is exactly n, right? So this is what we saw. And then we saw that, you know, this has applications in many fields and subfields of physics and allied areas. And then we also said that it's possible to do better, not just make a statement about the average or the average of the square of the random variable. In fact, you can get the whole probability distribution for the unbiased random walk, and that turns out to be this binomial distribution. And then we claimed that if you do use the Stirling approximation, you can get it to take this Gaussian form. So one question which would arise is, of course, the precise method one uses to go from equation 9 to equation 10, which is what I gave you as homework, but another is to ask, how reasonable is 10 with respect to 9? Okay, maybe it is an approximation. How good an approximation is it, right? So this is the agenda for this module, to explore this question. And in fact, it turns out that you can do this check. I asked you to do this analytically by hand, but you can even ask Mathematica to do this for you, right? I mean, so that is also something for you to play with. You can actually try to use some commands like simplify and log of n factorial. That's not something that I'm going to do now, but you can try it and see. You can get Mathematica to suggest for you approximate forms. Okay, so what I want to do here is actually just use the plot command, right? And so in fact, if you want to pause the video here and carry out these two tasks which I have laid out for myself, and it'll be good if you can do it your own way and then cross-check against mine. Maybe you have a better way than what I have. So plot on the same graph the full expression and the approximation
as a function of n and see how far larger n this works out, right? That's the first one. So I have plot exact. I'm going to call it plot exact, and then I'm going to make a list plot of this table. So table is so n, as you know, if I have to define n factorial, it must n must be an integer, right? So if I stick to integer values of n, then factorial is of course very well defined. But it turns out that there is a generalization of this. You can actually play this with Mathematica and check for yourself that in fact Mathematica is happy to compute factorials of non-integers for you, right? So there is a generalization of the notion of a factorial. If you have not already seen it, you might check this out in a math methods type of textbook. Alternately, even better is for you to play with this, right? Just use the factorial function and plot it on Mathematica. Plot just the factorial as a function of n and not list plot like I have here. You can even use just the regular plot. But here, for simplicity, I'm choosing factorial of n and n going from 1 to 10 in a discrete manner, and I create a table of this. Table will generate for me an array, and then I will use list plot to plot all these discrete numbers. Right, so that's what plot exact does, and then I can go ahead and compare against plot approx. As you can see, the right hand side of equation 11 does not give you any undue restrictions on what n should be. Even if you, let's say you started out with no knowledge of the generalization of the factorial function, so the left hand side seems to demand that n should be an integer, but the right hand side, there is no such restriction, as you can see, right? And so in fact, there is a way to generalize your n factorial, the idea of an n factorial, such that this formula would work out in any case, right, for arbitrary real values of n. Okay, so I have here a list plot for the exact function after it has been discretized and put it into an array using the table command. So likewise, I have a table of the approximate function from the right hand side. So now the question is, how large must n be before these two functions start to agree with each other, right? So let me run this, and then I will use the show command to make both of them appear on the same graph. And as you can see, the agreement in fact becomes extremely good even for very, very tiny values of n. It's not like n has to be some huge number before you start seeing it. You can see that even for n equal to 3 or n equal to 4, already this is an excellent approximation. And so indeed, for large n, basically these two are indistinguishable. For all practical purposes, they will be the same, really. And so sometimes you might encounter the Stirling formula in a slightly different way. So this is, this has some more information in it, which actually you can actually neglect, one of these terms for very large values of n. So you can in fact take an exponential of this whole thing on the left hand side and on the right hand side. Then you can write it as, n factorial is approximately like n to the n times e to the minus n, times another factor which can be neglected, right? So that is also something for you to check. So in fact, what you should do is make a plot of n factorial, like I said earlier, and check first of all that this factorial is a reasonable function for arbitrary n, not just for integer values of n. That's the first thing to do. Second is to plot on the same graph e to the n times n to the n times e to the minus n. So if you can plot this function, which clearly also can take any real value of n. There is no restriction that n should be integer, right? Both of these, and check for yourself that indeed these two curves will agree with each other very well. That's going to be your exercise problem. Okay, then next what I want to do is compare. We have used, I'm claiming that if I use this is also something which I will allow you to verify for yourself. If I use the Stirling approximation, as in equation 11, and plug it into equation 9, there is a way to go to equation 10, and that's for you to verify, right? But here what I want to do is again use the plot function to plot equation 9 and equation 10, and then see how well they superimpose upon each other and in what limit, what happens, right? That's what I want to do. That's the second exercise. And in order to do this, I will use the manipulate command, because I want to vary my n itself. So I'll allow my n to go from 10 to 100, and then I will plot each of these distributions, one of them the approximate and the other one is the Gaussian form, and take m to go from minus n to plus n. Right? So I'll generate this, and then I have I see, so n appears in many contexts, so but let me use this again and then it should be fine. Yeah, so it is fine. So now I can go ahead and vary n. So there you see, after a point the two curves are just totally indistinguishable. So you see that at this value of n, whose value you can check if you so if I put n equal to around 15, I can see that there is a some distinction between the two. When n equal to 10, for sure you can see, but if when n equal to maybe around 30 or 40, let's say, already the two are basically indistinct. For n equal to 50 and so on, it becomes better and better, and you don't even realize that there are two curves there. There's just one. They all look the same. Okay, so this is something for you to play with and check for yourself that indeed this the distribution function obtained here, of course, you know, m will only take discrete values, right? But on the other hand, here it takes all values. So the point is that when n, capital N, becomes large, you know, the difference between adjacent discrete numbers becomes so tiny. So, and it, in that sense, this will your distribution will also become a continuous distribution. It's not just for discrete values of n or discrete values of small m, but you can treat m to be a continuous degree of freedom. All right, so this was just a quick module where we revisited some things which we already saw, and then I am giving you a sort of a motivational direction, so to speak, to check these things for yourself. But there are still a few more things which I have left undone, which remains to be done, and I'm leaving that for you guys, right? One of them is to actually verify that equation 10 comes from equation 9 if you use the Stirling approximation. And the second is to test for the equivalence between, you know, these two forms with n factorial and e to the minus n times n to the n, using, you know, similar plotting and trying to superpose one on top of the other. All right, so that was a short module on this kind of comparison. Thank you.